Okay, the next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 1994 in the name of Gillian Martin on carbon capture, utilisation and storage as part of Scotland's net zero ambitions. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd ask members who wish to contribute to press the request to speak buttons or place an R in the chat function. And I call on Gillian Martin to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Ms. Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In securing today's debate, it's my intention to allow a good airing of the extremely strong case for the Scottish cluster and that pivotal component of it, the ACORN project, Carbon Capture Utilisation and Storage Project, to be given Track 1 status by the UK Government as soon as possible. But I want to make it absolutely clear from the outset that none of my remarks in any shape or form suggest that the two projects that have been given support by the UK government, that's HyNet and the East Coast clusters in England, do not deserve the status that they have been given. They absolutely do. My argument is this. In order to respond to the climate emergency, we need the Scottish cluster to be given Track 1 status too. In fact, just last night, Deirdre Meehy of Oil and Gas UK said at the cross-party group in oil and gas, convened by my friend Fergus Ewing, she went even further. She said, we should be throwing the kitchen sink at this. There is no point
I will do.
Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you. Isn't it the case that if George Osborne hadn't pulled the funding from the Peterhead Carbon Capture Project in 2014, that this technology would be up and running by now?
Gillian Martin.
Yeah, Jackie Bailey makes a very good point. We'll never forget the disappointment.
Jackie Dunbar, I think.
Did I say Jackie Bailey? Jackie Dunbar. I'm so sorry, Jackie. And the other Jackie. Jackie Dunbar makes a really good point. I will never forget the sense of betrayal, particularly people of Peterhead had, and indeed industry partners in Shell and other companies had when the feet from that were cut from the project. Deirdre Meehy says, we should be throwing the kitchen sink at this. There's no point in taking bets on a winner. We should be giving all five projects equal support. We also need to wake up to the fact that our current power, heating, transport, construction and manufacturing systems still emit more CO2 than the targets we aspire to. Until we drastically reduce those emissions, and it's not an overnight process by any means, we can reduce their harm by capturing them and, in many cases, using them as materials for other things. In short, CCUS is the answer to... I'll take an intervention from Mark Ruskell.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank Gillian Martin for giving way? I'm just thinking that if we throw the kitchen sink at CCS, where will the public funds come to actually crowd in investment in renewables? Surely we need to make choices about which technology we wish to deploy public money to get the biggest bang for a buck and the biggest cuts in carbon emissions.
Gillian Martin.
I agree to a certain extent because it's not either or. It's both combined. And I think that as long as we have emissions out, CO2 emissions out there, that we you know, for industries that maybe find it really difficult to decarbonise, that we need to have some way of capturing that carbon. But that does not preclude us from doing the things that you've mentioned. And we've had this conversation before. Of course, the everything is around CCUS is backed up by the Committee for Climate Change, who in their advice to both the UK and Scottish governments stressed that CCUS is a key requirement in meeting our climate change targets, which I'm afraid I've taken two interventions, one which of course are in line with the Paris Agreement we signed up to and the commitments made at subsequent COPs, including this year's in Glasgow. The Climate Change Committee's 2019 Net Zero report states that given its strategic importance in achieving decarbonisation, CCUS is a necessity for a net zero target. And the committee's chief executive, Chris Stark, said this, the ACORN project is a slam dunk, in my view, for support. Of course, there's I have already taken two interventions, I won't be taking any more. Of course, there is another very important thread to this, and that is that the just transition for our workers as we reduce our reliance on burning oil and gas over time. And this is not just a northeast issue. Families all over Scotland are reliant on oil and gas and their supply chains for their incomes, either directly or indirectly. But a project like Acorn, situated in Peterhead, and my colleague Karen Adams' constituency, will be well served by the talent pool we already have in the North East. And that's another significant argument for it to be put into Track 1 immediately. We have possibly the most concentrated transferable skills base right on our doorstep, as well as the universities and local companies to enable the innovation that will surround the project. And I'm aware of a few university-led projects which have already ready-to-go uses for the captured carbon, including one who came to speak to me a couple of years ago that will convert the carbon into fire-retardant bricks for house building. In economic terms, the Scottish cluster will contribute 1.4 billion per year GVA on average up to the year 2050. Job creation will begin as early as 2022 if the cluster proceeds on track one, with the construction phase alone supporting 7,000 jobs. And once completed, the cluster will support an average of 15,000 jobs per year right up until 2050. That is a significant amount of jobs. Longer-term expansion of the cluster would unlock further economic benefits, safeguarding of industrial jobs across the whole of the UK, particularly in those sites that are otherwise hard to decarbonise. And there are so many people who get this. And I include my Conservative friend and North East colleague, Liam Kerr, who wrote this in a very good article in the Press and Journal in August. He said, "As the UK looks to demonstrate global leadership on low-carbon technologies ahead of COP26, I'm calling on MPs and MSPs to back the Scottish cluster. With its energy expertise and heritage, existing infrastructure, and ready to deliver projects, Scotland is an ideal place to start this next phase of our net zero journey." And I hope that he will join me in urging his party at UK level to listen to his words, because Liam Kerr is absolutely right, and you can bank that. Sir Ian Wood, on hearing... I will do.
Liam Kerr.
I'm genuinely very grateful for Gillian Martin's words, and I don't actually disagree with an awful lot of what she said today. I think, crucially, Gillian Martin will acknowledge that the UK government has backed Acorn so far with £31 million. Is she aware of how much the Scottish government has backed Acorn for so far?
Gillian Martin.
That's probably a question for the minister, but I mean, I think it's a case of, like, if you've put that investment in already, why kick it into the long grass? That's really my point. It's no time to waste on this. Sir Ian Wood, on hearing the news that the Scottish cluster was kicked into the reserve list by the UK government, also did not mince his words. And he said, "This decision makes little economic or environmental sense and is a real blow to Scotland. Scotland is the most cost-effective place to begin CCUS in the UK, given the capacity for CO2 storage in the North Sea and the existing oil and gas infrastructure available." But one of the reasons the Acorn project is so vital is it has the capacity to store carbon from industrial sites across the UK, including Ineos at Grangemouth, the Cavendish project at Thames Estuary, as well as more local sites like Peterhead Power Station. In fact, there are memoranda of understanding already in place between Acorn and emitters across the UK. But Jackie Dunbar was right to flag up in her intervention about the history around CCUS, and this is another betrayal in that respect. Presiding officer, I will finish now. I've run out of time. I've taken too many interventions. We cannot make the same mistake again. We must all, regardless of party, urge the UK government to give the Scottish cluster track one status immediately for the sake of just transition, thousands of livelihoods, but most of all, for the sake of our drive to net zero targets that we all signed up to. Presiding officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Martin. I'm conscious of the number of people who want to speak in this debate, so I am keen to get everybody in. If anybody wants an intervention, could they please make an intervention rather than intervene from a sedentary position? And I call Douglas Lumsden, who will be followed by Karen Adam. Mr Lumsden, around 4 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'd like to thank Gillian Martin for bringing this important members' debate today. As the carbon cluster remains an important project for the UK government, I would like to start by saying that I very much hope the project will go ahead and as quickly as possible. But the SNP position on carbon capture is, quite frankly, ridiculous. The position seems to assume that you only have either carbon capture or oil and gas. And I have to tell Gillian Martin that it's a false choice. Carbon capture works hand in glove with the oil and gas industry. In fact, the oil and gas industry are leading the way in new technologies associated with carbon capture, utilisation and storage. Yes, I will.
Gillian Martin.
Can the member point to any part in the speech that I've just given where I have made that assertion?
Douglas Lumsden.
I thank the member for that intervention. It's more the SNP position, not Gillian Martin's actual position. As we heard from the First Minister just last week, that, you know, it wasn't just Cambo oil field she wanted to stop, all new oil fields to stop, and to think of the impact that would have on the jobs and on the North East. And that is a betrayal, quite correct. But of course, the SNP position, whilst reckless, is not as absurd as the Green Partners position. The Green Party website states the Greens will oppose public investment in carbon capture and storage as it's unproven, and the vast majority of projects are linked to enhanced oil recovery. But thanks to a couple of ministerial cars and a bump in salary, I'm sure these green principles will be thrown out the double-glazed, well-insulated window. And maybe the member should send a letter to her green colleagues and try and get them on board with the carbon capture project, because we need carbon capture and new oil and gas developments. Gillian Martin's own constituent, former First Minister Alex Salmond, commented only this week. He stressed the need for new oil and gas developments and how vital they are for the North East. He said, without it, then it's not just farewell to tens of thousands of North of Scotland's votes for the SNP. Much more seriously, it's Mossmorran no more, Grangemouth no more, St Fergus no more, and independence no more. Yes. He knows that the SNP are betraying the North East, and I would urge the North East SNP members to call on their party to stop this constant talking down of the area and the energy industry, and get behind the industry and start protecting the 100,000 jobs that are at stake. And the Press and Journal is reporting today that the North East recovery is falling behind the rest of the country. It's time for the SNP to focus on the day job and start understanding the realities of the situation that we're currently living in. To cut oil and gas exploration means that we will have to import more and vital jobs will go elsewhere. But instead of offering solutions, the SNP simply adopts the usual grievance politics of blaming Westminster with no proposal or ideas of their own. No, I don't have time, sorry. Colleagues, carbon capture is a fantastic initiative for the North East in partnership with the industries that have brought wealth and prosperity to our region. Carbon capture is possible to do while protecting vital jobs, meaning our net zero commitments, and working with industry. I want this project to go ahead. It will go ahead, and I'm confident of that. Instead, the SNP grievance project focuses on talking down the project as if it's somehow game over. Government support or not, the project is highly dependent on external private investment, and the SNP's constant cries of grievance is putting that investment at risk. The North East deserves better than this failed coalition of chaos that turns its back on the North East at every opportunity. This government's failure to invest, engage or support the North East is a disgrace. They prefer to play grievance politics than actually engage, and that is to the detriment of Scotland.
Thank you, Mr Lumsden. I now call on Karen Adam, who will be followed by Paul Sweeney. Ms Adam, who joins us remotely, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Gillian Martin for bringing this forward for us to debate. The Westminster decision to relegate Scotland's Acorn project to the second division is an illustration of misunderstanding the potential of the Scottish energy industry and betrayal of our future generations as we witness what has been called the terrifying march of climate change. It would have been a case of third time lucky with the first attempt 20 years ago, and in 2015, the £1 billion UK-wide CCS competition, which was cancelled by the then Chancellor of the Exchequer, George Osborne. Even in 2018, the UK government admitted that the then infant Acorn demonstrator project had merits. Perhaps if the proposal to build a Peppa Pig land in Peterhead had been on the table, we may have had a different outcome. Presiding Officer, I may jest, but this is no laughing matter, and neither is the investment in a just transition needed to secure jobs, and transfer from the inevitable wind down of the fossil fuel sector. The experienced and hard workers of the energy sector in the North East deserve security. The North East as a whole needs this investment, which will undoubtedly benefit Scotland and the world as we potentially lead the way in just transition and innovation in the carbon capture and sequestration industry. I've recently had meetings with Acorn prior to and following the recent decision, and I can say that I'm convinced that Acorn will roll up their sleeves and will prove Westminster wrong one way or another. This will not be the end of their story and Scotland's story. It's not easy to forget that at the beginning of this year, INEOS and its joint venture partner in Grangemouth, PetroChina, committed to developing Scotland's first CCS project with Acorn. And in July, it was announced that the Acorn CCS project agreed to partner with INEOS and Petronius at Grangemouth to capture and store up to 1 million tonnes of CO2 by 2027. If the Tories will not support Acorn, I'm confident that there will be those that may well do so. If they don't, as Energy Voice has said, maybe it will be time to say to Acorn, get on with it and tell the Tories to take a hike. Once again, so much opportunity left to the long grass of what seems like punishment. My predecessor, Stuart Stevenson, had said, we've had enough of stalling. The UK government must now get on with delivering the project at Peterhead. Well, to all intents and purposes, it has failed yet again. It's difficult to be objective when we see the preferred bidders as two competing projects in what can only be described as red wall territory. And to add pain to the loss of jobs, the loss of socio-economic advantage, and to add injury to the despair and betrayal felt in and around my constituency, we're left without any meaningful explanation as to why the Acorn project has not been chosen in the top league. It is perceived as a purely political decision. As the industry has observed, objectivity, that got lost somewhere. And this is worth repeating. Sir Ian Wood, he's another stakeholder who I met not long ago, has said that Scotland is the most cost-effective place to begin CCUS in the UK, given the capacity for CO2 storage in the North Sea and the existing oil and gas infrastructure available to repurpose for CO2 transport and storage. He also urged Westminster to rank Acorn alongside the winning so-called Tier 1 projects. Presiding officer, I finished by speaking up for my constituents who have voiced their anger at this decision. Thousands of jobs not created, a huge missed opportunity. Acorn will keep the door open and the ear open to Westminster, I have no doubt. But if we adopt the tone of COP in Glasgow, we do not have plenty of time to make a real and meaningful difference. Opportunities must be seized. We must live adventurously, and others will not wait whilst Westminster drags their heels. Just get on with the investment, do the right thing for the people that you propose to have broad shoulders for. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Adam. I now call on Paul Sweeney, who will be followed by Fergus Ewing. 4 minutes, please, Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I thank the Member for Aberdeenshire East for bringing this very vital debate to the Chamber today and to emphasise the criticality of this project to Scotland achieving its net zero target by 2045. And that's why the Climate Committee described it as a necessity, not an option. And last month, the UK government announcing that the Acorn project would not be selected in the first round of plans for carbon capture and storage was surely galling for all of us to witness. The cluster is widely regarded as providing the most comprehensive business plan by industry leaders, and the UK government's announcement was condemned widely, indeed Sir Ian Wood describing it as being deeply disappointing. And urging the UK government to think again. Obvious carbon reduction benefits are clear. The proposal would have seen over 26,000 workers also being transitioned out of the oil and gas sector into lower carbon alternatives over the next 10 years, which is also a crucial aspect as achieving climate justice for workers. We all know how important the transition away from fossil fuels will be if we are to meet those targets, but we also know the importance of providing a just transition for workers, and that is why it's particularly galling and disheartening. And particularly focusing on energy production as well. Peterhead Power Station is Scotland's largest and only thermal generator. And without the ability to carbon capture, That will really put in jeopardy Scotland's ability to meet the 2045 target for net zero if we're not able to decarbonise the grid. And it actually is an interesting adjunct to the debate earlier on in First Minister's question about nuclear power. If we don't have that baseload decarbonised, then we're going to be in a really difficult position. And perhaps we shouldn't be surprised, of course, because in 2015, the Conservatives rode back on their commitment to the £1 billion carbon capture storage programme that was proposed for Longannet and Peterhead, and it was spelled out in their 2015 manifesto. And this year, we've seen the Tories break their promise on tax rises, rip up manifesto commitments on protecting the Chippewa Lock on pensions, and now we have this broken promise in the wake of COP26. It's hardly surprising, but it's certainly shocking. It's not just the broken promises and clear disdain for the Scottish cluster that's galling, it's the potential cost implications that go along with it. Happy to give way.
Stephen Kerr.
Paul Sweeney's seen the criteria against which these various projects were scored and ranked. Has he actually seen the criteria?
Paul Sweeney.
I have actually examined the criteria, and that's why I'm all the more perplexed at the decision that was made. And indeed, I have seen the scores, and I have to make it clear to you, that I'm perplexed at the artificial rationing of resource and investment in this. We need all of this happening concurrently. We don't need it happening sequentially. And that is the biggest problem. And the argument that it really doesn't, you know, it doesn't certainly help when you're trying to advocate the benefits of pooling and sharing resources in the United Kingdom when this sort of thing happens. Surely someone somewhere in Whitehall, particularly in the Treasury, would have seen the political implications of this and made it clear that the Scottish cluster had to be a priority. And not only that, it's because of the Chancellor's dogmatic adherence to the 3% of GDP cap on capital investment that this has been rationed in the way it has. When UK debt borrowing is lowest in history, and the debt burden facing the country is at its lowest in history, why on earth wouldn't you want to pump that investment in now to unlock huge multiplier effects, increasing employment and increasing gross value added for the Scottish economy? It's a one-way bet, and it's just baffling that the Conservatives haven't seized this opportunity, and I would urge them to reconsider their position. We really need the government to look again at this. It's a decision that will hamper long-term investment in the Scottish cluster, an investment that is desperately relied upon and will harm our chances of reaching that net zero target whilst providing a just transition for workers. We need all five UK projects in the pipeline for carbon capture and storage happening simultaneously and now, not just HyNet and the Teesside Humber East Coast cluster. Scotland has 60% of the UK's storage potential, so surely it makes sense to have carbon capture and storage presence in Scotland on that basis. I would really urge the Scottish Conservatives to speak to their colleagues in Westminster and have this decision reversed. It's the right thing to do for our economy, for our climate ambitions. And frankly, if the Conservatives had any real ambitions for Scotland, this would surely be a no-brainer.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. Before calling the next speaker, I'm conscious of the large number of members who still want to contribute to this debate. So I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.1.4.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. And I invite Gillian Martin to move such a motion.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed. The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are members agreed? Thank you. That is agreed. And I now call on Fergus Ewing, who will be followed by Maurice Golden. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr. Ewing.
Presiding Officer, this debate is, I believe, one of the most important of our time. And therefore, Gillian Martin is to be congratulated for bringing it forward. And I'd like to begin by thanking members from virtually all parties for attending the cross-party group on oil and gas yesterday evening. It was really informative, and I hope we can work together across the chamber to promote objectives, which I think increasingly we should be able to find a consensus upon. And part of that consensus must be that the Scottish cluster, the ACORN project, perhaps improved, perhaps with more emitters and more CO2, must go ahead if we are to achieve the net zero targets. But it must be said that the record of the UK government on CCS is one of consistent breach of promises. Promises made first by ministers in respect of Longannet, and then in 2014 by Ed Davey and David Cameron, who visited Peterhead Power Station to announce that that would be the CCS scheme. Announcement with a fanfare of trumpets, a fanfare, presiding officer, of veritable Wagnerian volume, as I recall, at the time, patting themselves on the back on what they were about to do for Scotland. And now ACORN, number three, Scotland, CCS, once, twice, three times a loser under UK government decisions. That is the record of fact. But there is a fourth opportunity, and we must grasp that, presiding officer. I think the member might be interested in what I've got to say. We should work with experts in Scotland. The Scottish Centre for Carbon Capture and Storage, the Minister will know, when I was in his position for 5 years, I worked with people like Professor Stuart Hazeldine, a world leader, and who, with Drs. Emma Martin Roberts and Stuart Gilfillan, published a report earlier this month which said, in short, that if we proceed at the current rate, we can only capture 10% of the CO2 that we require to meet net zero. Now, I wasn't the brightest boy in the class, but I never went into an exam saying, I'm determined to achieve 10%. That's not ambition. That's capitulation. So what do we need to do? And I say this in all sincerity with absolute conviction, that we need a number of things. We need a successful, working, thriving oil and gas sector. And that's because without such a sector, we cannot deliver CCS. They have the expertise, and no one else does. So if you think about it, if we accept, and everybody except people on the fringes accept, that CCS is a sine qua non of reaching net zero, we need an industry to deliver it, presiding officer. And I think we should recognise that the North Sea operators, led by OG UK, have set a world-class standard, setting to cut emissions by 50% by 2030, cutting flaring, cutting methane, using the most carbon-friendly, least-emitting practices. And as Sir Ian Wood said, if we stop domestic production, then we import more gas from Qatar, 59 kilograms per tonne as opposed to 22. We increase, not reduce, emissions. Signing officer, let me finish by saying that we must go ahead now with the Acorn project. And if the Prime Minister doesn't listen to this debate today and says no for a fourth time, he will be committing an act of betrayal worthy of Cassius and Brutus in the assassination of their great friend, Julius Caesar. The Prime Minister is fond of quoting Latin phrases. The last word on Scottish CCS, on the tombstone of CCS in Scotland, must not be et tu, Boris.
Thank you, Mr. Ewing. I now call on Maurice Golden to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Mr. Golden, 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Let me start by saying how pleased I am that the SNP agree with so much of Conservative policy on carbon capture. Like us, they support the technology, want to see it play a part in net zero, and believe it can help create a just transition in the North East. And with common goals, it makes sense to collaborate. So it was deeply disappointing to see the SNP do the opposite this week. Instead of working together on carbon capture, the SNP issued a needlessly hostile letter to Scottish Conservative politicians. Full of confrontational language, it was more a political rant than a sincere attempt at dialogue. It's a bizarre choice to target colleagues who share common ground with you. And let me be clear, I was disappointed the fantastic Acorn bid didn't place higher, as were my Scottish Conservative colleagues. But the bid is still live. Yes, happy to.
Gillian Martin.
I'm very, very grateful to Maurice Golden. One thing I would ask him is, what interaction have you had with the decision makers in the UK government about your disappointment?
Maurice Golden.
I have had no interaction with the UK government. I know some of my colleagues have been representing us in that, but it's important to note that I do not have a reporting mechanism to the UK government. I am not accountable to the UK government, and I have no bosses in Westminster other than when Douglas Ross is there. And to suggest otherwise is absolutely outrageous. The British government are still engaging on it, and that's all the more reason to work together to get it over the line in round two. So why are the SNP trying to pick a fight? Let me explain. Their hostile letter isn't really about carbon capture, net zero, or the North East. It's just a tacky PR stunt, trying to whip up grievance at Britain and divert attention from SNP failings. For starters, why are the SNP targeting Scottish Conservatives? We support carbon capture. It's the Greens who oppose it. They would shut down Project Acorn in a heartbeat. So where is the SNP letter to the Greens? Better yet, why don't the SNP use that energy to come up with a clear industrial roadmap to support carbon capture? Professor Stuart Hazeldine has already warned about the lack of one and made it clear it is the British government forging ahead on this. And we know the British government is serious about a low-carbon future. Just look at the North Sea Transition Deal, cutting emissions, supporting up to 40,000 jobs, and investing up to £16 billion in new technologies, including carbon capture. The same can't be said for the SNP. Their INTOG plan puts a paltry 100 megawatt cap on floating offshore wind innovation projects versus 300 megawatts in the rest of the UK. Their failure to act will put Scottish projects at a disadvantage and risks costing the North East its preeminence in renewables. And this is the sort of foot-dragging failure the SNP are trying to hide. Their £100 million Green Jobs Fund took over a year to pay anything out. They have delayed the deposit return scheme. Their active travel target won't be met for 290 years. Added to that, recycling target failed. Biodiversity target failed, renewable heat target failed, and on emissions, they have failed, failed, and failed again 3 years in a row. When will SNP MSPs stand up to their Holyrood bosses who continually fail to tackle climate change? So let me be clear, the Scottish Conservatives want to tackle climate change and see carbon capture succeed, and we most certainly want to see the North East succeed. If the SNP share those goals, then let's them see them ditch the cheap PR stunts and work with us for the common good.
Thank you, Mr. Golden. I now call Mark Ruskell to be followed by Liam Kerr. Again, 4 minutes, Mr. Ruskell.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank Gillian Martin for raising this topic for debate here? And of course, in her previous role as convener of the Environment and Climate Change Committee, she'll be aware of the unanimous cross-party concerns about a reliance on CCS to cut Scotland's emissions by a quarter by 2030. And in fact, the committee went further. It called for the Scottish Government to produce a Plan B alternative in its report on the climate change plan just in February this year. So as we head towards the beginning of a new climate change plan cycle next year, I hope the minister is aware of the pressing need to come up with that Plan B. Now, you know, capturing carbon emissions and storing them underground appears at face value like a part of the solution, right? But the unfortunate reality here is that the history of CCS deployment so far has been one of overpromise and underdelivery. At a time, just if I can finish my sentence, at a time when we need technology that can be rapidly and cost-effectively deployed in the next 8 years. If I can get my time back, I'll certainly allow.
I can give you your time back. Gillian Martin.
Just a very quick intervention that really, would the member not agree that the failure of CCUS has not been to do with the technology, it's been to do with the fact that funding has repeatedly been withdrawn from it?
Mark Ruskell.
I think the global context is that there has been a technical failure in terms of capture of emissions and other, and that's just the reality. I'll come on to some of that a little bit later on, but you know, the key test here, I think, that the key test here is whether CCS actually accelerates a phase out of fossil fuels to keep us under 1.5 degrees, or whether it just builds in dependence, delaying a just transition while diverting and crowding out investment in renewables. And I want to just sort of pose an example here, which is about blue hydrogen that would be produced using Acorn project for the carbon storage element. You know, the current plans are to blend blue hydrogen at a rate of 20% into the gas grid. But the question then is about the other 80% of the fuel mix, because it will continue to be natural gas burned in boilers with no carbon abatement at all. So at the point when we should be scrapping gas boilers in the next decade, we would be extending our dependency on a gas grid and gas fuel with blue hydrogen as the enabler. Now, of course, the argument will come back that this is a transition, and in the future we can switch from blue to green hydrogen, which is made from renewable energy. And I get that. But, of course, green hydrogen is going to be a precious and highly sought-after commodity that's going to be used to fuel the steel furnaces of Europe. And Scotland, I hope, will have a serious role in that. But it would be an expensive, low-grade use of that just to use it to heat our homes. So, look, I think there are critical questions to be answered about the effectiveness of CCS. And a recent report by the Tyndall Centre showed that the scale of deployment necessary to reduce emissions in line with our climate targets has not been demonstrated anywhere in the world yet, with projects receiving billions in public investment around the world, but with pretty minimal success. And in fact, right now, CCS capacity globally is at 0.1% of annual global emissions per year. So not only are these technologies currently under-delivering, but that capacity is not intended to significantly increase until 2030, with deployment taking 6 to 10 years from construction to completion, by which point our emissions targets will have already been missed. So, you know, there are, I think, critical questions we need to ask of government, which need to be answered. I mean, what guarantees will there be of the capture rate for those plants that are feeding into the ACORN project? What about the huge energy requirements to actually power CCS, which risks causing more emissions than it will actually capture? So, you know, presiding officer, it's been a couple of weeks since COP. Yes, the eyes of the world are on Scotland, and, you know, change, meaningful change, was demanded by the world. But we really need to have a critical eye, particularly when there are strategies and solutions that are coming from the boardrooms of oil and gas corporations, who, to be honest, have spent decades denying the even existence of climate change. Let's have a bit more critical thinking here about the deployment of these technologies.
Thank you, Mr. Ruskell. I now call on Liam Kerr to be followed by Audrey Nicholl. 4 minutes, Mr. Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thought it would be helpful to just clear up some of the areas where some speakers seem to have misunderstood some crucial facts. So, Karen Adam said that it was a political decision, yet she appears unaware that there were objective criteria for approval, which all bidders knew and pitched to. Paul Sweeney said that the ACORN project had the most comprehensive business plan. Now, given that it's unlikely that he can have seen and compared all of the scoring, that might be somewhat difficult to substantiate. But in any event, he appears to be unaware that only one of the criteria pertained to how far along a project might be. Now, Gillian Martin, amongst what were otherwise very fair and measured comments, suggested that the UK government might have betrayed the North East. Yet, as I intervened on her, the UK government has backed the Scottish cluster with £31 million already. If Karen Adam really had been listening to the people she purports to have met, she would know the UK government continues to work with the partners,
absolutely,
leading SSE to report, "We are engaging with the UK government and our Scottish cluster partners." The UK government, far from kicking it into the long grass, has told the ACORN partners to keep working towards going live and has continued regular meetings between Storegga executives and ministers and Bays and the Treasury to move the project on. And I have to remark that the SNP's constant griping and politicking really is not helpful. Their position today is rather undermined given they're in coalition with a party whose manifesto explicitly rejects the idea of CCUS. If it was up to certain government ministers, we would have no carbon capture projects at all.
Exactly.
And I had heard no public protest, not one, from any of these SNP members when the tawdry deal was being stitched up. And, Presiding Officer, I have heard no public dissent from North East SNP members as Sturgeon performed a handbrake turn on Cambo and signalled her willingness to throw the North East oil and gas industry over a cliff. That is betrayal, Presiding Officer.
What did Member give?
Very briefly, Mr. Kerr.
Briefly, Mr. Kerr.
Making an excellent speech and is clearly in command of the subject. You mentioned the £31 million the UK government is investing in this. How much has the Scottish government put in?
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful for the intervention. We'll listen to what the Minister responds to that later, but to the best of my knowledge, the Scottish Government has put in £0.
Nothing.
And the important part about the investment is this is all part of a bigger picture. Acorn, like the oil and gas industry, needs investment, especially external foreign private investment. I think the Minister might do well to actually listen to my comments here. That requires stability, collaborative working and integrity, not manufactured grievance and division in both Parliament and the media. Now, one other thing, Presiding Officer. Karen Adam mentioned the SNP's much-trumpeted £500 million Just Transition Fund. Now, I've submitted around 10 parliamentary questions on this to the Minister. And, Presiding Officer, the fund is a soundbite. There are no details about when, where, to whom, from whom, or for what it will be paid. We don't even know which budget it's coming from. And the contrast with the UK government's £16 billion North Sea transition deal. Yeah, that's 32 times larger than the SNP's soundbite, which is planned to deliver 40,000 new energy jobs, could not be more stark. Then there's the energy white paper, the 10-point plan, previous and ongoing investment in offshore wind, carbon capture, and as announced yesterday, £20 million for tidal energy. This has been shown to attract around £15 billion of private investment, satisfying Mark Ruskell's intervention on Gillian Martin earlier. Presiding Officer, that's what Kwasi Kwarteng meant when he said the UK delivers plans, not platitudes. It is time for the SNP to do the same. So I say to the SNP, enough. Enough of the grievance, the division, and the misinformation. Let's work together with the UK government, the partners, and the industry to make Acorn happen. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. I now call on Audrey Nicholl, who will be followed by Alex Rowley. Again, 4 minutes, Ms. Nicholl.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I also would like to thank Gillian Martin for bringing this important debate forward today. My constituency of Aberdeen South and North Kincardine has oil and gas running through its veins. So I'm invested in Scotland's journey to net zero and to opportunities that carbon capture and storage will bring to my constituents. Our global population continues to grow, so does energy demand, so too carbon dioxide concentrations, and so too global temperatures. There are differing schools of thought on how we get to net zero, one being a suite of technologies that include the capture and storage of carbon dioxide emissions produced through power generation and other industrial processes. Carbon capture and storage is not a new technology. One of my constituents recently reminded me that CCS has been used in enhanced oil recovery since at least the 1970s, using captured carbon to re-inject and boost reservoir pressures. For some time now, carbon capture and storage has been the subject of ongoing focus as a vehicle by which skills from the oil and gas sector can become a force of good in supporting Scotland meet its climate change obligations.
Douglas Lumsden.
Yeah, I thank the member for taking an intervention. I was really just wanting to ask, does she agree with the First Minister when the First Minister said, you know, there should be no new oil and gas development?
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the member for his intervention. My interpretation of what she said is that until the appropriate climate compatibility assessments are undertaken, given the original licensing was many years ago, then until that point, there should be no new progress on that. That is my interpretation. So according to the UK Offshore Energy Workforce Transferability Review that the Robert Gordon University published, 90% of oil and gas industry jobs have medium to high transferability into net zero industries, not only by virtue of the industry's experience in implementing and operating large offshore infrastructure projects, but also through its extensive knowledge of subsurface technologies, reservoir management, and transport and storage of substances. And in terms of capacity, Oil and Gas UK's Energy Transition Outlook report outlines a total capacity to hold 78 billion tonnes of CO2 under the North and Irish seas, about 190 times greater than the UK's annual emissions of 400 million tonnes. But of course, there are challenges too. Friends of the Earth have expressed concerns about the positioning of carbon capture and storage as a climate solution, linking education providers, training organisations and the private sector more effectively. And in his research on North Sea carbon capture, Dr. Ashbek Agarwal of the Robert Gordon University highlights challenges including carbon pricing and infrastructure and industry leadership of CCS rather than government. However, he also concludes that CCS is both desirable and feasible going forward. In this regard, the Scottish cluster that we have already heard a great deal about is working to unlock access to one of the UK's most important CO2 storage resources through repurposing existing oil and gas infrastructure. It's therefore hugely disappointing that despite the potential for the Scottish cluster to support an average of 15,000 jobs per year to 2050 and £1.4 billion a year in gross value added, it was selected as a reserve cluster by the UK government, compromising our ability to take crucial action now to reduce emissions, not just in Scotland, but across the UK. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government has committed some £500 million to a new Just Transition Fund for the North East and Moray over the next 10 years and is calling on the UK Government to match that investment.
She's just concluding, Mr Kerr.
Thank you. Like many members here today, I will continue to urge the UK Government to match this funding commitment, and I urge the Scottish Government to continue reflecting its commitment to net zero by using all its powers to support carbon capture and storage opportunities within our wider just transition.
Thank you, Ms Nicol. I now call on Alex Rowley, who will be followed by Dean Lockhart. I'm encouraging all members to stick to the 4 minutes from now on. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When I saw the motion raised by Gillian Martin on carbon capture, utilisation and storage, I had no hesitation in supporting that. I support the view that carbon capture is a crucial tool and can be used as part of the broader solution needed to reach net zero in Scotland. We cannot, as a country, kid ourselves that all carbon emissions will be stopped altogether, nor can we pretend that reaching net zero will be a simple process. We still require large-scale, energy-intensive processes, whether they can be cement production, chemical processing, hydrogen production, or indeed power generation. On top of this, we have to consider the carbon produced by agriculture and by transport. Obviously, in order to reach net zero, we will have to massively reduce the amount of carbon entering the atmosphere. And I support measures to see this happen. But we also have other means at our disposal to reach net zero targets, and carbon capture is just one of them. The United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change Fifth Assessment Report states that globally it would cost 138% more to restrict the rise in global temperatures to no more than 2 degrees Celsius without carbon capture and storage. This shows that while not producing carbon in the first place may be more ideal, using carbon capture can help balance the environmental impact and the economic concerns as we move to reaching net zero. And the technology has come a long way. Now carbon capture use and storage technologies can capture more than 90% of CO2 emissions from power plants and industrial facilities. Scotland has so much potential to play a major role in the advancement of this technology, and we cannot fall behind the rest of the world as projects elsewhere expand. Just 2 days ago, Singapore announced targets to capture at least 2 million tonnes of carbon. We have the potential to be at the forefront of demonstrating the benefits of this technology, especially given that there are just 27 operational commercial carbon capture and storage facilities globally. This is why, when I saw the news that the UK government was not supporting the decision to invest in carbon capture at this stage in Scotland, I, like many other in the chamber, was dismayed. Yep.
Liam Carr, briefly.
It's a bizarre assertion. The UK government clearly is supporting this, but decided this on objective criteria. Does the member not acknowledge that?
Alex Rowley.
I actually think that people were astounded given the progress that has been made. And I think you just really need to be honest, accept that, stand up for Scotland and make the case as the rest of us are trying to do. I am happy to support the Scottish Government in their calls on the UK Government to reverse this decision and invest in the Scottish cluster as a national priority. Had this been done for the first time around 2014, when the UK Government also didn't invest, we would be well on our way to making carbon capture more fully established in Scotland, and in turn the UK would be further on its way to meeting its own climate targets. Given we have just had COP26 right here in Scotland, it is good that the discussion around this is back to the forefront. But at the same time, we also have to recognise that carbon capture is only one tool at our disposal. At the same time, there is no question that we have to reduce carbon production, and that means pursuing greener energy, greener production methods, and greener processing. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, we also need to expand woodland, restore peatlands, both of which play a major role in storing carbon and have a clear long-term future.
There is much that we can and should do, and I hope
the UK Government will recognise that Scotland has an integral role to play.
I now call on Dean Lockhart, who will be followed by Neil Gray.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Let me start on a note of consensus. The Scottish Conservatives' position has always been that carbon storage will play a vital role in the transition to net zero. And that's all the more important after agreement was reached at the Glasgow Climate Pact on Article 6 of the final outcome in relation to international carbon markets, making carbon storage all the more important going forward. One of the other fundamental takeaways from the Glasgow COP was the absolute necessity for governments to work together and for constructive engagement between parliaments, politicians, the public sector and the private sector. And this is where I have to take issue with the SNP's approach to this debate. To suggest that the UK government has utterly betrayed the North East is not just factually wrong, it is counterproductive to our collective efforts to transition to net zero. And it's playing politics, frankly, with the climate crisis and the future prospects of the Scottish cluster. Presiding Officer, the UK Government's support for the North East and the renewable sector in Scotland speaks for itself. I've only got 4 minutes. I'm very happy if the Scottish Government want to bring a full debate on this, I'm very happy to give way in that debate. The UK Government brought forward the North Sea Transition Deal, investing up to £16 billion in the sector and the region, supporting over 40,000 jobs. Just this week, the Whiteley Green Hydrogen Storage Project was announced, the first of its kind in the UK. And again this week, the UK Government announced £20 million a year for the development of tidal stream electricity. More support for the sector in Scotland. And Presiding Officer, I don't have time. Presiding Officer, let's not forget, all of this is on top of the 75,000 jobs and the 10,000 businesses across the North East that the UK Government has saved during the pandemic, helping the North East economy keep going in the face of the global pandemic. And when it comes to the Scottish cluster, as my colleagues have highlighted, the UK Government has already invested significantly and continues to support the cluster. It made clear that the cluster will be central for the future of carbon storage in the UK. £31 million has already been invested in the project, and we'll hear from the Minister shortly whether that's £31 million more than the Scottish Government has invested in the cluster. The cluster is now first reserve and on track for further investment, and all of this has been underpinned just last month by the UK Government announcing the most ambitious £10 billion low-carbon hydrogen energy plan in the world, something that will secure the future of carbon storage across the UK and in the North East. Presiding Officer, it has to be said, this massive investment by the UK Government stands in stark contrast with the track record of the Scottish Government in the renewable sector. A government that promised to deliver 130,000 jobs in the sector, only for 20,000 jobs to be delivered. A government lost tens of millions of pounds of taxpayer money on the Palamas and Aquamarine wave power projects, and a government that has put at risk £600 million of Scottish taxpayers' money to prop up the Gupta GFG alliance, all for the sake of creating just 44 jobs. And when it comes, as my colleagues have said, to the much-vaunted £500 million Just Transition Fund, many in the sector fear this is just a headline announcement and will go the same way as the mythical publicly owned energy company. All spin, but something that will never see the light of day. But listening to this debate, Presiding Officer, I think the ultimate irony is the concern expressed by SNP members about saving jobs in the North East. Just a week after Nicola Sturgeon announced opposition to the development of the Cambo oil field, effectively confirming that the SNP Green Coalition want to close down the oil and gas sector in the North East, with the loss of 100,000 jobs, losing the massive technical expertise of workers and businesses across this sector, and requiring Scotland to import oil and gas in the future. Someone said soundbites, but that's precisely what your colleague Fergus Ewing highlighted that would happen if the Cambo development doesn't go forward. My concluding message, Presiding Officer, is let's stop playing politics with the climate crisis. Let's see the Scottish Government work together with the UK Government to transition Scotland to net zero.
Thank you, Mr Lockhart. I now call Neil Gray, who will be followed by Stephen Kerr again. 4 minutes, Mr Gray.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. I'd like to congratulate Gillian Martin for securing this debate and commend her for once again standing up for her constituents and for the wider North East, a doughty campaigner for them, and that has shown through in her contribution today. I also want to support the case made by Gillian Martin on the need to support carbon capture and storage in the North East, in addition to the projects already in receipt of Track 1 support, and then move on briefly to our wider net zero ambitions. As we've heard today already, the Scottish Cluster's ACON project was the most advanced project submitted to the UK Government. That's not my assessment or that of the Scottish Government. The UK Government scored St Fergus as being the most liberal carbon capture project anywhere in the UK. The infrastructure is already there. The workforce is there already. Everything is in place. So it's crazy that the Scottish Cluster has been left behind. And while it's not the end of CCS in the North East, it certainly makes it much harder. It puts jobs at risk, up to 20,000 to be exact, and also the decarbonisation of Grangemouth, Scotland's largest industrial emitter. But to add insult to injury, the reserve status ACORN has apparently achieved gives no guarantee of future support and still cuts the cluster out of any further future potential Treasury funding streams, lending of last resort or gaining storage liability, meaning the Scottish cluster is now at a very clear disadvantage. This is bad news for the North East and our net zero ambitions, and the Tories know it. And this isn't the first time we have been let down for short-sighted UK government decisions. As Fergus Ewing said, we remember Longannet and the £1 billion funding promised for CCS in Peterhead in the run-up to the 2014 referendum, only for David Cameron to renege on that promise the following year once that one area of constitutional difficulty was out of the way. I'm really sorry, but I would, given the strictures already imposed by the Presiding Officer in terms of time, I'm conscious of that. The UK government must urgently review this decision on the Scottish cluster and provide the necessary support to the ACORN project as quickly as possible. And they must also review their decision on the support being provided in other areas for us to meet our net zero targets. Yesterday, the Prime Minister announced £20 million to support marine tidal technology, which on the face of it sounds great. But in reality, the UK government is about to miss another good opportunity. The UK and Scotland in particular is already home to this potentially game-changing technology for the energy sector. The tidal industry has the potential to generate £1.4 billion to the UK economy and support 4,000 jobs. Just as importantly for our net zero objectives, tidal stream technology is predicted to provide 11% of the UK's, not just Scotland's, but the UK's electricity.
Sorry, Mr. Gray, enough chuntering. Mr. Kerr, you'll have an opportunity in a second to actually make a speech of your own. Please continue, Mr. Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The support offered by the UK government is less than a third of what is required by the industry. Just as with carbon capture, the tidal stream industry has been let down when we need to be doing all we can to encourage its swift expansion. In the meantime, as they are £50 million short for the tidal industry, which is based here, the UK government is committing billions to new nuclear power stations. If they don't invest now, we will lose this investment, lose the technology, lose the jobs. Alan Brown, Stephen Flynn and Ian Blackford continue to make the case for both CCS and Tidal Stream at Westminster, and I hope the Scottish Tories could join them in standing up for these crucial Scottish industries and making the case for them both to the UK Government.
Thank you very much indeed. Mr Gray, now calling final speaker in the open debate, Mr Kerr, for 4 minutes, please.
Deputy Presiding Officer, let me congratulate Gillian Martin for bringing this motion to the Chamber. And she gave an excellent speech, except for about the last few words of the final paragraph. And I also want to thank Fergus Ewing, who gave an excellent speech, again, except for a few choice words mixed in along the way. But Karen Adam and Neil Gray, honest to goodness me, I mean, in all honesty, and including Neil Gray's comments about the Tidal Stream sector, which, by the way, are so misguided, it's almost unbelievable. I disagree completely with the motivation behind today's debate, as has become apparent from the contributions from certain members of the SNP. The conversation about the UK government's support for CCUS clusters should focus on environmental benefits they will provide. And sadly, the motivation for today's debate comes directly, I'm afraid, from the SNP's one-page playbook, stoking up. I wish I could. Honestly, you have no idea how much I'd love to give way to the member, but unfortunately, I'm not allowed to.
I'm perfectly able to take an intervention, Mr. Kerr. I'm telling you, you will still be restricted to just around
exactly.
4 minutes.
So it's all about stoking it. This is the one-page playbook of the SNP, stoking up grievance against the UK government. This narrative is and always has been false. So rather than have the SNP's inward-looking approach, our efforts to protect the climate must be about cooperation. We must work together with our partners across the UK and countries around the world. COP26, hosted by the UK government in Glasgow earlier this month, showed the challenges and frustrations that cooperation can involve, but it also showed that through hard work, patience and determination and cooperation, things get done and will get done. It produces positive outcomes that put us on the path to protecting our planet. And it is with the same spirit of cooperation and the determination to do what is best for our planet that I certainly approach this debate and this motion. As part of the UK government's net zero strategy, 4 CCUS clusters will be operational in the UK by 2030. And it is world leading. Amazed, but not entirely surprised to hear the Greens discussing the need for us all to be so conservative about these things and not make any strides forward because no one's ever done it before. The attitude that was portrayed by Mark Ruskell, I'm afraid, is exactly why the Greens are on the fringes of political debate in this area. 2 of these clusters will be operational by the mid-2020s and the other 2 by 2030. And last month, the UK government's energy minister, Greg Hands, announced that the first 2 clusters will indeed be in the East Coast Cluster and HyNet. But the Acorn project in Aberdeenshire has been designated as a reserve site in the first phase and will continue to receive UK government support. And being designated as a reserve site also leaves the Acorn in a promising, I would say, advantaged position to be selected for full support in the second phase. Determining which clusters would be selected was always going to be a competitive process based on objective criteria, and Paul Sweeney has certainly not seen the scoring, by the way. And while it's disappointing that the Acorn project will not receive the full support that we all wanted in the first phase, it is fundamentally misleading and self-defeating for the SNP to say that the UK government have abandoned Scotland. All that language about betrayal and the stuff in that letter that was sent to us was outrageous. The important thing here is meeting the carbon goals we all agree on, not necessarily what part of the country the projects appear in what order. When carbon is captured and stored, we all benefit, whether we are in Scotland, England, or indeed in any other part of the world. To reduce carbon reduction targets to tit-for-tat, pork barrel politics is to betray the science that sits behind it. We must act locally and think globally. I can sense you're about to tell me I have no more time. So let me conclude by simply saying, it is my hope that in the second phase, and we will work across this chamber to this end, that the Acorn project will be part of the next phase and will get full support. The technology, Deputy Presiding Officer, deserves our support. it can be a major contribution to our carbon reduction targets, and it deserves than SNP, leavings and spend.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. Can I apologise to the speakers, the later speakers in this debate, that I have curtailed their time a little. It has been a debate, obviously, that was heavily oversubscribed. I will, however, protect a bit of time for the Minister in responding to the debate to take interventions if he wishes, and I call on Richard Lockhead to respond to the debate for around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Can I start by thanking Gillian Martin for lodging this motion on carbon capture, utilisation and storage, highlighting a technology which will play a crucial role in helping Scotland decarbonise and reach our world-leading statutory emissions targets by 2045. And she has rightly and eloquently highlighted the consequences of the recent UK government failure to award the Scottish cluster, led by the Acorn Project in Aberdeenshire, track one status and funding in their recent cluster sequencing process. The cluster was previously considered the most advanced and deliverable CCS project in the UK, yet was rejected by the UK government, and as Sir Ian Wood said, it's like leaving your best player on the subs bench. And it's fair to say that the public, industry, and Scottish ministers, and many, many others, were shell-shocked by the decision. And I honestly hoped that today we could all stand together and say this is a serious mistake that must be corrected without delay. And Gillian Martin has also drawn attention to the northeast of Scotland, the home of oil and gas, and a natural home for CCUS development and deployment. And the UK's decision risks a just transition to good green jobs that region urgently needs, and that members across all the parties keep calling on the Scottish Government to support. The Scottish Government supports CCUS as a means to decarbonise industry and as a vital tool to achieve Scotland's emission targets.
I'll give Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. Just to take him back to the northeast industry, Fergus Ewing rightly pointed out that when Acorn is up and running, it will need a supply of oil and gas. Does the Minister support Nicola Sturgeon's view of future oil and gas or Alex Salmond's position on future oil and gas?
Minister.
I'm actually just about to come to that theme, and Alec Rowley mentioned the importance of COP. I spent 2 weeks of my life at COP. I saw ministers from the UK government, Scottish government, tens of thousands of people from across the world and NGOs saying together that the planet's burning, that we have to take faster action, we have to be braver, and we have to be bolder. Yet the Conservatives and Liam Kerr, the zero, net zero spokesperson for the Conservatives, in this debate have been attacking the SNP government for saying that we should transition away from fossil fuels in Scotland and play our role to save the planet. Now, our 2045 net zero target is based in part on advice from the UK Climate Change Committee, who describes CCUS as a necessity, not an option, as Gillian Martin said, and significantly, who pointed to Scotland's CO2 storage potential in recommending that date of 2045. I think you were first.
Maurice Golden. Maurice
Golden. Thank you. I was heartened to hear that the SNP is going to finally meet the targets, specifically the 2013 household waste recycling target of 50%. Will the Minister confirm that will be met next year?
Minister.
The Minister gave a statement to the Parliament just last week in the circular economy. But what I can say, and again, in response to the many attacks on the Conservative benches on Scotland's climate change record, is that we have reduced more emissions as a percentage than the rest of the UK. But we don't hear one word of credit from these benches in terms of Scotland's progress towards our climate change targets. But CCUS is a very important transition opportunity for Scotland's mature oil and gas industry, utilising the existing skills and expertise of those across Scotland to transition to a low carbon economy, again, as many members have said. And the livelihoods of significant numbers of oil and gas workers in Scotland is at stake. And recent figures show the oil and gas sector currently supports around 70,000 jobs in Scotland, with the Scottish cluster, which we're debating today, could support an average, as we heard, of 15,100 jobs from 2022 onwards. Can I say to members, I'll take Fergus Ewan briefly.
Fergus Ewan.
I thank the Minister for giving way. With regard to the future operations of the North Sea oil and gas, operators. Does the Minister welcome the opportunity that exists now to build a consensus across almost all parties that the forthcoming climate compatibility checkpoint, which I understand the UK government, having consulted upon this since last September, are bringing forward, offers an opportunity to demonstrate that future production can continue, provided it meets the high standards, which I hope will be the outcome of that particular consultation and will enable the 71,000 jobs to continue for the foreseeable future?
Minister.
The Scottish Government has asked the UK Government on several occasions to be involved and to be included in the conversations about the compatibility test for future oil and gas fields in the North Sea. And I think anyone following COP would think it's a very sensible position to take that the green light should not be given to any fields until we've seen that compatibility test applied. But if I can just return to the jobs, this is crucially important for this debate. 70,000 jobs in oil and gas at the moment, with the Scottish cluster and the Acorn project likely to create 15,000 jobs from 2022 onwards, that's just next year onwards. And to put that in context, the number of green jobs put at risk by failing to support this one project of many that's happening, represents over 20% of existing jobs in the oil and gas industry. So the UK government's decision means that some of these employment opportunities will be delayed or even lost. And the UK government's failure to support the Scottish cluster is a blow. It's a blow to Scotland's net zero ambitions and to people of Scotland, and particularly communities in the northeast of Scotland who are so dependent on that energy transition. And we have announced £500 million just transition funds for the northeast. And we've asked, of course, the UK government to help by matching that as well. And we're also supporting those in carbon-intensive industries with a skills guarantee and take the final intervention.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. Just on that point, does the minister agree with the former SNP golden boy, Fergus Much, in the P&J just today, when he says that that Just Transition Fund is a drop in the ocean?
Minister.
And that's why we want the UK government to match it. So I'm glad that he agrees with the point, and hopefully he will make that representation to the UK government. But in terms of the transition, the Acorn project is at the heart of the transition everyone's calling for to be supported. Scotland has vast potential for CO2 storage in the North Sea, remaining the best placed nation in Europe to deploy it. And the Scottish cluster projects clearly presents the best opportunity to develop industrial emissions reductions at scale by the mid-2020s. When asked about the UK government decision, the Climate Change Committee CEO, Chris Stark, stated that the cluster seems a slam dunk for support, again, as Gillian Martin said, and then noted that we should be able to get a third project going and that the Scottish project would be a really good candidate for that.
Stephen Kerr.
Have I got time?
Yes.
When he said that this announcement from the UK government is a substantial step forward that lays out clearly the government's ambitions to cut emissions across the economy for the coming 15 years and beyond, factoring in the fact that there's going to be further announcements.
Minister.
What he said was it was a slam dunk for support, but of course it didn't get that support in the announcement from the UK government, and that's today. Hopefully we can all rally around and make sure we get the Scottish project included in track one as soon as possible, because Acorn is expected to store over 6 million tonnes of carbon dioxide a year by 2030. And that's roughly 10% of Scotland's current emissions. And they also plan to take that up to 20 million tonnes by 2040. So I better reach a conclusion, but the decision by the UK government not to award the Scottish cluster Track 1 status is illogical. It shows a clear lack of ambition. It's a huge missed opportunity for green jobs in Scotland, particularly in the northeast of Scotland, and it's a lack of leadership on climate change. And again, as Sir Ian Wood said, who described it as a decision which makes little economic or environmental sense and is a real blow to Scotland. So I urge all the parties to heed Gillian Martin's advice, to all stand together, to make the case that this project is absolutely essential for Scotland to meet its net zero ambitions, to deliver green jobs as part of the energy transition, in particular in the northeast of Scotland. And therefore, we need the mistake that was the rejection of the Acorn project, to be corrected as an absolute priority so we can get this off the ground, get going, and get the transition underway and help Scotland meet our net zero targets.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting briefly until 2:30 this afternoon.